100 years ago, July 11, 1922, the Hollywood Bowl officially opened for its first summer season. It's celebrating its centennial season this year and has a great history. And it's thanks to women that the Hollywood Bowl was born and ended up here. 1916, there was a huge production of Julius Caesar in Beechwood Canyon that tens of thousands of people came to. That showed popularity of outdoor concerts. 1918, Christine Wetherell Stevenson did a concert of The Light of Asia, Crotona. Once again, tens of thousands came. So people realized the beauty and the weather of Southern California made outdoor entertainment a possible thing, and it's a great way to be entertained during a relaxing summer night. After the success of The Light of Asia, Christine Wetherell Stevenson helped organize an association to develop, find a location for an outdoor amphitheater in Hollywood to help make Los Angeles and Hollywood the Athens of America and celebrate entertainment and the fine arts. In the late teens, a father and son by the name of the Rosses came over and discovered the beautiful natural acoustics here of Daisy Dell in Bolton Canyon. Miss Stevenson and Marie Rankin Clark gave over $21,000 each to help buy almost 60 acres here to found what would become the Hollywood Bowl. It was actually one of the early conductors who came up with the name in 1920 of the Hollywood Bowl because of its shape. Later that year, unfortunately, Miss Stevenson did leave. They decided they did not want to make it just a spiritual play that would run continuously. So she went across Cahuenga over here to build what is now the Pilgrimage Play in her own amphitheater. But they did, in 1921, had their first unofficial season. It was an Easter service, high school graduation, a high school performance of Twelfth Night, and the women did a huge Armistice Day celebration in November. Their first official season was in the summer of 1922 for this to be the permanent home, summer home, of the Los Angeles Philharmonic. July 11, 1922 was the first official performance of Carmen with a cast of hundreds, if not thousands. And it was helped by this the help of Addie Mason Carter. She had founded the Hollywood Community Chorus and Hollywood Sing, which is organizing people together to sing in the outdoors. She was so enthusiastic, she got those attendees to give money and to help improve the bowl, because that year all they had was temporary benches, a flat stage with a canvas roof. So from that point on, they were always working to improve the amenities and the conditions of the bowl, be it seating, stages, etc. 1926, they get the first sort of elegant stage. Myron Hunt came up with a basic shell, but then they hired Lloyd Wright, the son of Frank Lloyd Wright, to create something more elaborate. His first shell, an asymmetrical pyramid, was, though it had great acoustics, was considered too avant-garde. So that was torn down, and later that year he came out with concentric circles, which is basically the shape of the bowl now, though it has changed a few times over the century. So that has changed, and over time the grounds and things have changed. They've gone from just sidewalks to walk up to moving sidewalks to beautiful outdoor picnic areas, to a store and museum and other types of material as well. In 1922, the bowl was founded, and from that moment on, they've continuously worked to improve their facilities and amenities, from landscaping to picnic areas to museums. Well, in the 30s, they decided they needed a more elaborate entrance to help draw guests and audiences in. They received a federal grant from the government and worked with the Work Progress Administration to put unemployed people to work. They hired artist and sculptor George Stanley to help create this beautiful streamlined Meridian entrance. He had won awards, but and had also done a bas relief at the telephone building downtown, as well as the refined Bullock's Wilshire department store. Stanley is perhaps most well known for sculpting the Oscar statuette that the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences awards each year. He designed the beautiful Muse of Music statue here that celebrates both music and the arts, and helps celebrate the gorgeous natural beauty of this amphitheater. The fountain was added as well. Once again, it adds a refreshing touch to help you relax from the moment you walk in the entrance here to the Hollywood Bowl. From its beginnings, the Hollywood Bowl has had picnics, and it was because this location, Daisy Dell, was known as a favorite picnic area for people in Hollywood because it was just blocks from Hollywood and Highland, and people could easily walk here. Once the bowl came in 1922, they realized that was a wonderful way for people to come and enjoy an evening. They could come have a leisurely picnic and then go to an inspiring concert. Over the years, the picnic areas evolved. Originally, it was like the seating area. Then it became benches and little areas around the bowl. Eventually, across the street, over around the Hollywood Heritage Museum, the picnic tables as well. The little area where I'm sitting now in the teens and 20s had been a little community, religious community of cabins where people lived. Over the decades, many of the homes were torn down, but it was acquired by the city and county and is now a historic cultural monument. A few of the bungalows survive as offices for LA County and the Hollywood Bowl. It's a very secluded but beautifully landscaped little picnic area to come and enjoy yourself, be it on a regular day just to read a book or to have a picnic, or before going to the bowl. And a picnic is a great way to enjoy an evening at the bowl. It helps you escape the modern world, refresh yourself, and get ready to be inspired for a few hours. So the Hollywood Heritage Museum, we are now having changing exhibits virtually every month, showing off artifacts that we have in our collection, trying to inform people of a variety of things in Hollywood. And one of the things we currently have up is the centennial exhibit of the Hollywood Bowl across the street. We have artifacts from posters to photos to programs and other artifacts showing the history and the evolution of the Hollywood Bowl. From its inspiration, a 1916 concert in Beechwood Canyon of Julius Caesar, to posters in the 70s of the Grateful Dead coming and performing at the Bowl. A variety of things have gone on at the Bowl. It was inspired by Christine Wetherill Stevenson and her Light of Asia production, a Theosophist production. She wanted actually to continue that at an outdoor amphitheater as they came up with the idea for the Bowl, but the association decided to go in other directions, and that's when she formed her pilgrimage play Across the Street. But they did go on with Easter services at the Bowl. And many things over the years. It started out strictly classical because it is the summer home of the LA Philharmonic. And over the years, it's gone more and more popular, where now it's more popular concerts and very little classical. Some Easter Sunrise Service has always been a very popular program at the Bowl for people to come to. But many important personages in the arts as well as Hollywood have taken part at the Bowl. Paul Robeson, one of the great African-American performers, he was a natural athlete, singer, orator, performed at the Hollywood Bowl in his early days in the 40s. Also, we have Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong performing there and recording an album that was there. The Hollywood Bowl was always ahead of its time in welcoming people of color in the 1930s. They had African-American composer perform pieces that he had done, and actually he got to conduct. And they had other African-American performers, Native American performers perform. They were very inclusive almost from their beginning. In 1943, David O. Selznick had a extravaganza production honoring Madame Chiang Kai-shek. She'd come to the United States seeking help from the United States for China in their fight against Japan. And of course, the United States needed their help in Asia against Japan. She started on the East Coast and then ended up here in Hollywood. Selznick's production was over the top. It had virtually every band from every military branch playing their theme songs as their soldiers came in. It was a grand pageant with Walter Houston and Edward G. Robinson performing, and people like Spencer Tracy and Henry Fonda made introductions. Such women stars as Mary Pickford, Myrna Loy, Greer Garson, Irene Dunn, Shirley Temple, Judy Garland, and Dinah Durbin took part as well. A crowd of overflow crowd of 30,000 came at a time when only 5,000 people could actually come to concerts because of the war. We've had, as I mentioned, as they started changing and becoming more popular, Hollywood became a more integral part. In the 1930s, 1934 to be exact, German director Max Reinhardt did a massive 8 production of Midsummer Night's Dream, featuring such people as Mickey Rooney and Olivia de Havilland. It was such a massive success that Warner Brothers decided to make a film adaptation starring some of the people from the production, like Richard Cromwell, Rooney, and de Havilland. Over time, things continued to change. 1943, Frank Sinatra made his Bowl debut, one of the first popular concerts. In the 1950s, Duane Eddy was one of the first rock and roll performers to perform at the Bowl. And by the 60s, we're getting people, Sonny and Cher, 1966, they performed with the Righteous Brothers. Later, we have Jefferson Airplane, Jimi Hendrix, and the Grateful Dead performing at the Bowl. They're bringing, always trying to introduce new audiences to the Bowl, stay up to date with the times, bringing in all different types of things. As we mentioned, the Bowl changed its shape over its 100-year history. It started as a flat stage with a canvas roof, and over time, in the 20s, they decided to first build a stage, an oval stage. In 1927, Lloyd Wright, son of Frank Lloyd Wright Jr., Frank Lloyd Wright, did first a very avant-garde pyramidal stage that was too avant-garde and did not last very long. And then he came up with the idea of the concentric circles, which is basically how this stage has evolved and remained until this day. Here are some great shots. If you see the steel frame as it's going up with the concentric circles, looking up Daisy Dale and Bolton Canyon to the top of the hill. In 1953, they added a reflecting pool, the 100,000 gallons of water in front of the stage. Not exactly sure why they thought that was an idea, but they did. And then later they added a fountain, sort of dancing waters that had could be lit at night to add special effects. That remained for decades, where they took those out and once again added seats. Over time, Frank Gehry and other architects have added like the big round oval balls inside the bowls to help the acoustics and for the audience, and they've added video screens to help the audience see that what has happened. The Bowl is a continual evolution, and it's a wonderful place to go in the summer and enjoy a refreshing and relaxing evening of entertainment.